Well, we have a special day today. Every year we give the ICTP Prize. And for me, it's always an emotional moment because I was on the other side of the recipient side. And I remember very well, a couple of years ago, when I received the prize, and it was something, a very, very special occasion for me. So we'll start the ceremony. You all know the order. So let me just start describing the prize, and then I will say some words about the winner of the prize today, which is Pablo Mininni, who is here with us. So the ICTP Prize was created in 1982 by the ICTP Scientific Council to recognize outstanding and original contributions in physics and mathematics by young scientists under 40 from developing countries. So the ICTP Prize includes a sculpture, a certificate, and a cash award. So for this year, 2012 ICTP Prize citation, it says the 2012 ICTP Prize in honor of Marshall Rosenbluth is awarded to Pablo Mininni. The prize recognizes Pablo Mininni's important contribution to advancing the understanding of fluid and magnetofluid turbulence at the fundamental theoretical level, as well as working out a myriad of applications in astrophysics and atmospheric physics. The former, inter alia, includes probing the structure of nonlinear interactions and the ensuing cascades of energy and other ideal invariants. And the latter spans a wide spectrum of problems such as the solar cycle, turbulent dynamos, magnetic reconnection, rotating flows, and stratified turbulence. His work has made a strong impact on his very active field. So I would like to say some words about Pablo. Pablo Mininni received his diploma in 1999 and his doctoral degree in 2003, both in physics and from the University of Buenos Aires, UBA, in Argentina. His advisor was Professor Daniel Gomez. From 2004 to 2007, he was a postdoc and later a scientist at the National Center for Atmospheric Research in Boulder, Colorado, working under the supervision of Annick Bouquet, David Montgomery, and Daryl Holm. I know that he kept that position for several years after leaving because people didn't want him to leave. So in that sense, he went back to Buenos Aires, but kept coming back to Colorado for several years. Now he's a professor and chair of the physics department at the University of Buenos Aires. From 2008 to 2012, he was also a part-time scientist at the National Center for Atmospheric Research. Dr. Mininni works on the numerical and theoretical study of turbulent flows with applications in geophysics and astrophysics. In the field of fluid dynamics, his expertise includes parallelization methods for computational fluid dynamics, the application of statistical methods for characterization and analysis of turbulent flows, the spectral analysis of multiscale and multiphysics phenomena, and subgrid modeling for turbulent flows. Recently, he has also become interested in experimental aspects of fluid dynamics and geophysical flows. I have to say that I know Pablo for several years already because I was asked to be a member of a panel that I will assess the physics department of the University of Buenos Aires. And so I went with several scientists to interview people and so on. And at that time, they introduced me to the new head of the group. And I was looking around and I couldn't recognize because Pablo being so young and being such a very big physics department surrounded by very senior people, it was very impressive to see the young person take the leadership. And so now I have been seeing him here several times. And sometimes it's hard for me to make up my mind to see I'm talking to the head of the physics department of probably the best, if not the, one of the best, if not the best university physics department in Latin America. So that says a lot about Pablo. He's not only a great researcher, but he's also a great scientist in the sense that he takes commitments, he takes responsibilities, and he does it at the most efficient and professional way. His colleagues asked me to mention that besides being the head of the department, always busy with so many activities and so on, he always has time to talk about physics to anybody who comes to asking questions. So he's always surrounded by people asking him questions and so on, and he's delighted to share his knowledge and his ideas with everybody. So that's a symbol and an example of a model of a great scientist, and I'm very pleased that he's the awardee this year. So we have today not only Pablo, but also we are fortunate to have Harry Sweeney here. He's a very distinguished professor from the University of Texas. As I mentioned at some point, I had the honor to work in his lab when I was a student, and I was impressed that how experimental physics was so beautiful, and despite myself being the most dedicated theorist and always scared about the experiments, he told me that experimental physics is wonderful, and it's also it's great to have things being done with your own hands. So, and Pablo, Harry, will talk to us because he was also a close friend of the person for which this prize is named after, which is Professor Rosenblatt, one of the leading figures in his field, and also a professor in physics when I was a student at the University of Texas. So I will ask now Harry to come and say some words about Marshall Rosenbluth, and after that we will award the prize to Pablo.
I want to describe Marshall Rosenbluth's life and his story. He was born in upstate New York, in Albany, New York, and his family moved to the city of New York, where he attended the prestigious Stuyvesant High School, which accepts only a very small percentage of the applicants in this high school, which focuses on science. This high school is remarkable in having had many scientists, many graduates go on to become major scientists, members of the National Academy of Sciences, and a number of Nobel laureates. He graduated in 1942 from high school, and he entered Harvard University in physics. He was at Harvard a couple of years, and then was called to serve. Of course, this was during World War II. He was called to serve in the United States Navy and was trained as a technician. He said later in life, this was the only experimental effort that he made in his life, in only acquaintance. But he really appreciated it later in life to have had this experience in making things work and using equipment. So he spent 2 years in the Pacific during the war, and then he returned to Harvard and received a bachelor's degree in 1946. Notice with a two-year interruption in the Navy, he still graduated from Harvard in a total of 4 years. And then 3 years later, at the age of 22, he graduated from the University of Chicago, where he worked under Edward Teller, who was his advisor. Now, when he graduated, Edward Teller was the head of the weapons program at Los Alamos National Laboratory in New Mexico, and he strongly urged Marshall Rosenbluth to go with him to Los Alamos. But Marshall said no, he would rather take a postdoctoral position, and he went to Stanford for 1 year as a postdoc, but Teller was persistent, and the next year, Marshall went to join the weapons program at Los Alamos National Laboratory. Now, I'm showing several figures, I have to acknowledge. I got these from the Emilio Segre archives. Now, while Marshall was working together with Teller and a whole team of people on the design and development of the hydrogen bomb in the early 1950s, he continued to do basic science. And one of his major early contributions was this paper, which on the Monte Carlo method, which has become a standard technique used in many areas of science and engineering. This paper is at present time been cited more than 18,000 times. It's a landmark paper, and it was really Marshall Rosenbluth's work, as the others in the line of authors acknowledged later on. He's the third author. Metropolis became the first author because he provided, he was director of the computing section at Los Alamos, and he provided the computing time. As Marshall said in an interview in 2003, just before he died, he said, actually, he never had a conversation with Metropolis about the contents of the paper. But the computing time was indeed very valuable, and the actual coding was done by Marshall Rosenbluth's wife, Ariana, and that was critical for the calculation. Of course, Teller, head of the group, was also on the paper and also was not involved, really, in the development of the paper. And Teller's wife was added at the last minute on the paper at the request of Edward Teller. She had been involved in physics, but in the preceding couple years had not been directly involved in physics. And Teller said if she was going to get a job, she needed to show that she had some work in recent work in physics. Could her name just be added? And of course, Rosenbluth said yes. But this is really Rosenbluth's paper. And it was innovative in many ways. They had, with the largest computer available, they could only consider a small number of particles, 284 particles in their molecular dynamic simulations, but they used periodic boundary condition. It was a two-dimensional problem, so that not hard spheres, but hard disks. And they were calculating, actually, the equation of state, but it was their approach which was the important thing, more than the result for the equation of state for a gas of hard disk. They also introduced an innovative procedure for weighting the different configurations. It's the standard procedure now used. So, in working on the weapons program in the early 50s, Marshall was very involved in the development of the theory for the hydrogen bomb, and he went actually to the first test of the hydrogen bomb, which was on 1st of March, 1954. He went out to sea, he was on a ship in the Bikini Atoll, and observed the explosion. At a distance of 45 kilometers, the explosion was more powerful than expected by a factor of two. So they got a fair amount of radiation. And what was worse was they had arranged for the ship to be upwind when the explosion occurred. But just shortly before the bomb was exploded, the wind shifted 180 degrees and they were downwind. So he got a considerable amount, and everyone aboard the ship got considerable amount of radiation. And he actually died late in life, or in 2003, of pancreatic cancer. And he always wondered, was that a consequence of the radiation dosage he had gotten in 1954? After the bomb was exploded, the team that was working on that one could see many ways in which the bomb could be improved. You could get higher yields, and they had all kinds of ideas of making bigger and much bigger bombs and things that could be done with the bombs. And that had less appeal to Marshall, and he became somewhat disillusioned with the idea of building bigger and bigger bombs and began to think about the use of controlled thermonuclear fusion for production of energy for mankind. And gradually, through a period of 2 years, his focus changed from building bombs to a lifelong quest to develop controlled fusion as a viable energy source. And that was the focus of his research for the remainder of his life. And even late in life, he was the chief scientist for the large tokamak, which is under construction presently in France, for a period of time in the 90s. Here's a picture of him in the period after he left Los Alamos. So when he wanted to work on controlled thermonuclear fusion, he decided the place to go would be General Atomic in San Diego, because they had top theorists, plasma theorists, and they also had an experimental program, about the most advanced experimental program. So he could work on theory with top people and interact with the experimenters. And then in 1960, the University of California opened a new campus in San Diego, and he was a faculty member in this new institution. Now, this was a very tense period leading in the early 60s. There was very little interaction of scientists in the United States and the West with the Soviet scientists. And there was a lot of uncertainty about the direction that this these large weapons programs would take and the extent to which they would be used. I had some small, very minor role in that in 1960, 61, I was an electronics engineer. I was sent to working for the National Security Agency in Washington. And I was sent to Germany in the summer of 61. And a wall was under construction. And no one understood, certainly at my level and higher levels as well, just where this process was going. What was the purpose of the wall? And what would be the next step? I was very young. I was 22, and I was sent by the director of National Security Agency in Frankfurt, the NSA European headquarters, to Germany to work on a project to see if I might learn something. Let's leave it at that. And I arrived there in Turkey, in rural Turkey, and found that I had a group under me of 21 people, including an Air Force captain who was more than twice my age and easily more than twice my size. And I felt a bit intimidated. But he was a very good member of the team and helped to hold together the group of 21 guys who were working on the project. And it was an experimental project. We needed to listen to some signals, let's say. And we built some equipment. As an experimentalist, all of you who've been involved in experiments, know the first rule of experiments is that when you build something, it doesn't work. And I was to return to Washington and was asked to return at the end of my tour of duty. And we hadn't gotten it to work yet. And I said, we need more time. Because the way we planned to work, build something, didn't quite work. And we were given more time, and we got it to work, and we obtained the information that was needed. So this was a very exciting and a very tense time, because it was so uncertain in what direction the world was headed. And we had many conversations about the imminence of possible nuclear war and annihilation of major nations or large numbers of people. So Marshall was working at General Atomic, and he had an opportunity to work directly with the experimentalists. Here is the Taurus. He's looking at it. Here is Marshall Rosenbluth, and here are some other people who are well known to this group: Niels Bohr, Yudhakawa, and then the head of the General Atomic Fusion Division, Don Kirst, is here in the background. They worked very hard, very intensely, but of course they took time for coffee. Here's Niels Bohr, and the head of the theoretical physics department there, Lothar Nordheim. And Marshall, for some reason, has his eyes closed at that moment. Marshall was very interested in interacting with the Soviet scientists. It was essentially zero contact. And he met Abdul Salam, and Salam was just in the process of developing the idea for ICTP. And Marshall proposed that the first program of ICTP would be one that would bring plasma physicists from around the world, but in particular from the West, together with plasma physicists from the Soviet Union. And to his, somewhat to his surprise, Abdul Salam was enthusiastic about the idea. People thought that given Salam's own interests and accomplishments in particle physics, surely the first event would be a gathering of particle physicists. But instead, it was this group of theoretical plasma physicists from the West and the Eastern countries. So the chairs for the program were Rosenbluth, and then a Soviet chair, Kadamsev, and then from the United Kingdom, Bill Thompson. Marshall had also met earlier Role Sagdiev, who was very young but was already playing a major role in the Soviet program. And he came, and he and Marshall became close friends and remained friends throughout their life. Sagdiev is now at the University of Maryland, where he went in 1990. Now, Abdul Salam said it must be international. This is the idea of ICTP. And Marshall Rosenbluth and the others were very agreeable with the idea, and they invited scientists from many countries, and they came not only from the European community and Eastern Europe, which was at that time called behind the Iron Curtain, but also from developing countries, including India and Libya and Pakistan, and these listed here, and others. And then there was a proposal to invite scientists from Israel. And there was much objection amongst these others to inviting Israelis. But Salam insisted that if they were going to hold this conference, they must invite the Israelis. Everyone from any country was welcome. So the Israelis came. And Marshall Rosenbluth, in his 2003 interview, said it was like going to this meeting at ICTP was like going to Mars and meeting men on Mars. The Americans and Westerners had no idea what the Russians would be like, the Soviets. And likewise, the Soviets didn't know what to think of meeting these Westerners. But once they met, they immediately began to talk physics, and there was essentially no discussion of politics. They had an intense period of more than 3 weeks, 5 through 31 of October, in which they worked on problems in plasma physics, and they discovered that they had complementary areas of expertise. The focus of the problem was the instabilities that occur on a very large scale, which affect the stability of the confinement of the entire plasma. And the expertise of the Americans was particularly in statistical mechanics, kinetic theory, and making computer calculations, whereas the Russians were far ahead in analysis and in nonlinear theory. So they worked together and made much progress, and the results of their 3.5 week stay was a book or proceedings, lectures presented at the seminar at the International Center for Theoretical Physics, published by the International Atomic Energy Agency, and that became, for decades, the standard textbook in plasma physics. Now, this inaugural meeting, was so successful, Marshall proposed that there be a follow-up meeting that would be of longer period of time, a 9-month meeting in 65, 66, the year after this meeting in 64. And that was planned and held here for Marshall Rosenbluth and a number of others came and stayed here for the entire 9-month period. However, the Soviet scientists and many of the others were able to come for only short periods of time. And some of the leading scientists from different countries were here at different times. So it was not quite as productive as the initial program in 1964. But it was a very, very productive 9-month period. And it became called the golden year of plasma physics. It says this year, the year 1965, of work done here at ICTP is still known as the golden year of plasma physics. Now, Marshall moved from San Diego to Princeton in 1967 and was there for 13 years. And he was a member of the Institute for Advanced Study. But he interacted closely also and had an associate appointment at the Princeton Physics Plasma Lab. In the late 70s, he had some interactions with physicists in the plasma physics group at the University of Texas, particularly Bill Drummond, who was the leader of the group. And Bill talked to, I was on the faculty at the University of Texas, and Bill Drummond said, let's see if we can't recruit Marshall Rosenbluth to the University of Texas. So we had conversations with members of the department, in particular the president of the university, and the Texas companies that supported electricity industry. And Drummond was able to get funds from the Texas energy companies, power companies, which the university matched, and then they got a very large grant from the Department of Energy, large for theory anyway, not for experiment, to match that, and they established an institute, and everyone agreed that it would be, that the funds would be made available if Marshall Rosenbluth would be the director of the institute. It was contingent upon his coming. So Bill Drummond and I went, and a couple others, went to New York, went to Princeton. But we met with Marshall. I remember a very nice meal we had at the Palm Court of the Plaza Hotel in New York in 1979 and discussed with Marshall the possibility of his coming to Texas. And he ultimately agreed to come and came the next year. And here he is at the University of Texas. There were many programs, especially in the 1980s. Everyone, or almost everyone who was anyone in plasma physics came to the various conferences and came for long-term visits at the University of Texas. Unfortunately for us, after 7 years there, he left and returned to San Diego, to General Atomics, and remained there till the end of his life. In 1997, Bill Clinton awarded to Marshall the highest honor that is given by the U.S. government to a scientist, the National Medal of Science. And the citation reads, as you can see, for his fundamental contributions to plasma physics, his pioneering work in computational statistical mechanics, his world leadership in the development of controlled thermonuclear fusion, and his wide-ranging technical contributions to national security. All through his life, after he left, after Marshall left Los Alamos in the 50s, he remained an advisor to the Department of Defense. And there's a program of advisors called JASON, which he was very active in, at least in the early years after his leaving Los Alamos. And he continued advising up to the time of his death, advising the Department of Defense of the United States on matters of national security. So finally, just some quotes that were made at the time of his death. He died of pancreatic cancer in 2003. Marvin Goldberger, early in Marshall's life, called Marshall the Pope of plasma physics, and that stuck, and it was widely used through his life, that Marshall is the Pope. When he died, the obituary in the New York Times was very lengthy, and it says that Marshall was a central figure here in ICTP. Patrick Diamond is a plasma theorist who graduated with a PhD from MIT in 1979. He came then to University of Texas and worked with Marshall, and then moved with Marshall to UC San Diego in 1987. And Marshall said in a later interview that he considers Pat Diamond as the probably most eminent plasma theorist presently alive. He's certainly playing a major role in plasma physics today. And Pat Diamond said, what Marshall taught us was, he taught us that what was right was more important than who was right. And Larry Faulkner, a member of the National Academy, a very eminent chemist and a friend of Marshall's, said Marshall was motivated by his desire that science be used to improve the well-being of society. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Harry, for such a wonderful presentation. We learned a lot about Rosenbluth, but we also learned a lot about the role of ICTP, which I was not aware, which is very, very important. So, yes, I knew that ICTP was organizing the first activity in plasma physics, but I didn't know how influential that work was, and also the year after, so it's very good. Very good. So to follow with the program, I will now present the award to Pablo, and then we will ask Pablo to give us a scientific presentation. And I will ask Pablo to come here so we can have a nice photo.
Okay, thank you very much. I really feel honored to receive this prize. It means a lot to me. I want to thank the director of the ICTP, the entire ICTP community, the members of the committee, Professor Harry Sweeney, for being there. It's a real honor. The first time I was here at the ICTP, I was a young PhD student. It was probably like 14 or 15 years ago. I was in a plasma physics school, actually. And so the ICTP has played an important role in my career. I met who were later my supervisors during my postdoc here also at the ICTP. When they were going to hire me, I came to give a couple of talks in a meeting here, and David Montgomery came to the ICTP to interview me. So the ICTP played a really important role in my career, and this is a really important prize for me. So thank you very much. So I will talk a little bit about plasma physics, but most of my talk will be about fluid dynamics. I will talk about some of the most recent things I did. I will try to keep the talk as simple as possible with little equations. And I have a lot of slides, but I'm not planning to give the entire talk. So if you have questions, please stop me at any time, and then when we get tired, we stop. Okay? So, I have been working on the role of helicity in turbulent flows. Helicity plays an important role in plasma physics, tokamaks, space physics. And since when I moved from doing magnetohydrodynamics to hydrodynamic flows, I started to wonder what is the role of helicity in hydrodynamic flows. And this has been one of the motivations for my work in the last 6 to 8 years. The work I have done, I will show you, has been done with PhD students like Tomás Teitel and Paola here at UBA. Pablo Covelli, who's an experimentalist who has joined our group recently. Rafael Marino, Cecilia Rorai, two Italians that were at ANCAR a couple of years ago. Annick Pouquet, Dwayne Rosenberg, and more people I will mention at some point. So let me start by the Euler equation, fluid dynamics. So if you think of a fluid, the first thing that you think about is the Euler equation, which is basically just the Newton equation. So you have mass, this is acceleration, these are the forces. Euler came up with this equation in the 1700s. Okay, at that time, this equation was closed and complete only for incompressible and ideal fluids. Later, Navier and Stokes came up with the Navier-Stokes equations. Okay, so that's for a viscous flow. And later also people realized that the flow is not incompressible. You need, on top of this, you need an equation for the conservation of the energy. So, but this is all we will need, pretty much. So the Euler equation describes an ideal fluid, so no viscosity. So if you want to think about engineering flows, astrophysical, geophysical flows, atmospheric sciences, that's really the starting point. Okay, so there are a lot of applications that came up from this equation that was written a long time ago. Now, what is remarkable is there are, besides the applications, there are a lot of very, very fundamental problems that are still open. For example, we don't know yet, if you add viscosity to this equation, so you get the Navier-Stokes equation, so dtu plus u dot grad u. So this is the same equation, and if you just add viscosity, this is an incompressible fluid. We still don't know whether this equation has smooth and unique solutions for any time. Okay, so if you start from smooth initial conditions, we don't know whether this equation develops a singularity in finite time or not. Okay, this is actually one of the Clay Millennium Prizes. So it's a big problem. Okay, so we can, to introduce helicity and try to understand what is the role played of helicity in this equation, let's start by, we can rewrite this equation, this is simple algebra. We can rewrite this equation like that, where omega is the vorticity, it's just the curl of the velocity. And if you write the equation like that, it's immediate. So all the problem in either Navier-Stokes and Euler comes from this nonlinear term. Okay, this term is quadratic in the velocity. It's really easy to see that if the vorticity is parallel to the velocity, all the nonlinearities go away. So the equation becomes really simple, all the complexity goes away. And it's remarkable that people really took a long time to realize that. So flows that have the vorticity parallel to the velocity have no nonlinearities. Okay, if someone is worried about vector identities, the curl is not a vector, okay? So the vorticity can be parallel to the velocity. And I will show you a simple example next. That's a simple example. So any corkscrew motion in a flow will give you helicity. Okay, so then we can basically introduce this quantity, which is the helicity, which is basically the mean alignment in a volume between the vorticity and the velocity. So if the velocity and the vorticity are parallel, then the nonlinear term goes away. Flows that have a lot of helicity tend to be really stable and survive for very long times. Okay, so basically what we need is corkscrew motions if we have right-hand and left-hand corkscrew motions, we have zero helicity. But if we have all right-hand motions, we will have non-zero helicity. Actually, we will have maximum helicity. Okay, so what is remarkable about this is the following. Remember, Euler wrote his equations in the 1700. People only realized that helicity is a conserved quantity in the Euler equation in 1967, so only 50 years ago. Okay, so the first mention of helicity in a different context actually comes from plasma physics and space physics, and it was Walther and later Chandrasekhar and Kendall that realized that this quantity, the magnetic helicity, which is the inner product between the magnetic field and the vector potential, the magnetic field being the curl of the vector potential, is conserved in a magnetohydrodynamic flow. Okay, and actually, if magnetic helicity is maximal, since in MHD, the current is the curl in dimensionless units of the magnetic field, if the magnetic field is perfectly aligned with the vector potential, then the current is perfectly aligned with the magnetic field, so the Lorentz force goes away. And in plasma physics, this plays a very important role because what you get is force-free flows, flows in which you don't have the Lorentz force. And those flows tend to be stable. So these are really important flows for plasma, so in tokamaks, in space physics. So in 1967, Moffat realized that this quantity, which is the equivalent of the magnetic helicity, is conserved in the Euler equation. So the Euler equation for an incompressible flow conserves the mechanical energy and the helicity. Okay, this second conservation was only found a little bit more than 50 years ago. Now, another interesting property is that besides being a mean alignment between two fields, the helicity is a measurement of the topological complexity of a flow. So actually, you can show, and Moffat showed that quantities like these are associated with what people call the Gauss linking number. So the helicity is associated with the number of links you have in a field. So if a link like that, you can't break without breaking the lines. Okay, the only way you can break a link like that is with some dissipation, so you can blur the lines and open the chains. Okay, so two vorticity or magnetic field lines like that have helicity because they are linked. And the only way to change the linking number is by cutting the lines. Okay, so magnetic helicity and kinetic helicity are what people call topological invariants. Okay, that's another interesting property. Now, this is nice, we have another conserved quantity, but the thing is, we know that every time we have a PDE, we have a partial differential equation with conserved quantities play in physics a very important role. So then the question is, what is the role played by helicity? So we know, people understand much better what helicity does in plasma physics. So I will quickly give you a few examples. So we know that if we have a helical velocity field, a helical velocity field is really, really good at building large-scale magnetic fields by self-induction. So basically, the induction you have in a dynamo in a bike, you do the same with a conducting flow. You don't have wires, but you basically, from the motion of the conducting flow, you self-generate magnetic fields, okay, just by induction. So what we know is a helical flow sustains large-scale dynamo action. This is known since Parker. Pouquet, Frisch, Lurat has also showed this. Krauser and Radler also. So this is a depiction from a paper by Mitch Berger, who also studied magnetic helicity a lot. What you see here is basically a simple depiction of the velocity field in the sun. And in the sun, you have differential rotation, so the equator rotates faster than the poles. And then what you see in red are magnetic field lines, and you can get an idea of how a helical velocity field tends to create helical magnetic fields, which are force-free. Okay, so you basically get an equilibrium. So now, magnetic helicity, so well, in 2003 with Daniel Gomez, my PhD advisor, and Suarez Mahashan, we showed that this mechanism is also relevant when you take into account kinetic plasma effects. So it's not just a magnetohydrodynamic effect, but it's also relevant when you have some kinetic plasma effects. So now once you create these large-scale magnetic fields, which are helical, These large-scale magnetic fields, since they are force-free, they tend to be really stable. What you see here is a solar eruption. This is the reconstruction of the magnetic field lines using a method by Titov and Dumoulin. And what you see is the magnetic field lines are really twisted. So you have these structures in the solar wind and in the solar corona, which have a lot of helicity. So the role of helicity in space physics and in plasma physics is well understood. Now, when we go to hydrodynamic flows, the story is really is completely different. So let me give you just a couple of examples as motivations. So people in, for example, in atmospheric sciences has not paid a lot of attention to helicity until 1986. Lilly, in 1986, speculated that some structures in the atmosphere, actually convective supercell storms, are more stable and survive for longer times because they have a lot of helicity. What you see here, this is from the paper by Lilly, what you see here is helicity as a function of height measured in the atmosphere, and what you see here is a sketch by Lilly of how he imagined the velocity field to be in the convective storm, and you can see you have these links between the field lines. Okay, so Lilly said, okay, so maybe these structures are really stable and easier to predict because they have a lot of helicity. The problem with this paper is that Lilly assumed that helicity plays a role in isotropic and homogeneous turbulence. So he wrote a lot of simple examples of how helicity increases predictability and on how helicity increases stability of a flow in cases in which today we know helicity plays no significant role. Okay, so research in that area stopped for a while until recently Montgomery in 2006 and Levina more recently started to claim that helicity may play a role in the self-organization that leads to the formation of tornadoes. Okay, so, and actually today, even when we don't know the fundamental physics behind this, there are a lot of indices based on helicity that are used for forecasting of storms. So I will show you a few examples. These you can get from NOAA, you just go to the web page and you get the helicity today somewhere in the world. So these are contour levels with amount of helicity. Helicity is to, relative helicity is to, in storms is today used to get an idea of whether a storm may develop a tornado or not. And the idea behind is associated with what Lilly claimed, okay? So large values indicate an increased threat of tornadoes. You can also normalize the helicity by the available potential energy. That's a better index, and that's pretty much what you get. Okay, so now I will start, all this was motivation, I will start to tell you a little bit of what I have done in recent years. Let me give you a quick warning. I won't show fancy simulations of tornadoes. I will try to go after the simple physical problems behind all this, okay? So I will consider numerical simulations in simple domains. I will consider simple physics, either rotating flows or rotating stratified. I won't go into moisture or any of the fancy things you have in a storm. I won't, as a result, I won't claim helicity is responsible for the formation of tornadoes, but I will show you that we can learn a little bit about what helicity does in hydrodynamic flows. Okay, so the simplest problem I can come up with in which helicity plays a role is a rotating flow. So you can imagine we have a box, we put it in a rotating table. This is the simplest model you can imagine of the atmosphere. It's just a rotating flow at very large scales. Of course, stratification is really important, and I will talk a little bit about that. So we go back to oil or to Euler or Navier-Stokes, and to be in a rotating frame, what we need is we have to add the Coriolis force. Okay, so I will solve these equations numerically. This is a PDE. It's expensive to solve. Some of the simulations I will show you use from 20,000 to 40,000 cores and 10 to 40 million CPU hours. Okay, so if we don't have viscosity, as I told you before, we have two conserved quantities. We have energy and helicity. these equations have two parameters, the Reynolds number, which is the ratio of the nonlinear term to the viscosity, and the Rossby number, which is the ratio of the nonlinear term to the Coriolis force. So small Rossby number means strong rotation. Okay, these equations, by the way, conserve helicity. So helicity is still conserved in this system. So we will have to inject helicity somehow, and I will have a special spoon that will steer flows with helicity. Okay, so if we take the momentum equation and we neglect the nonlinearities, we neglect viscosity, we forget about the spoon I use to steer the flow, I'm basically left with the linear system. I'm left with du, dt, and the Coriolis force. And the Coriolis force acts as a restitutive force, so what we will have are waves. And it turns out that for this system, the waves are circularly polarized waves. So the waves are helical. We will have right wing and left wing polarized waves. Okay, so this is a system in which rotation breaks the symmetry. Without rotation, we don't have this breakdown of symmetry, but in this case, we have rotation breaks the symmetry and the waves are helically polarized. Okay? Actually, the dispersion relation for the waves are like that, and if we don't have dependence in the vertical direction, what we have is modes with zero frequency, so we don't have waves. Okay? So actually, this is really important. It's nice that we can learn some things from the linear problem. I will show you next some simulations of rotating flows, and you will note is what you will note is that the flow tends to develop large columns. And the reason why the system develops large columns is because modes with no vertical dependence, so with zero kz, have zero frequency, so those are slow modes, are what people call the slow manifold of the system. Okay, so let me show you how a rotating flow looks like. This is moderate resolution. This is a rotating flow without helicity. So this is a box that I put on top of a table, I make it rotate, and I have a spoon, and I steer the flow at some scale. Okay, the columns are not there at the beginning. They are formed in a spontaneous way by a self-organization process. I just have this special spoon that creates a flow with no helicity. And this is really important for what's coming next. So what you see here is entropy. This is like intensity of vorticity. This is vorticity square, actually. What you see here is energy. So blue means a lot of energy. Blue here means a lot of vorticity. And you can see we have these columns that have a lot of internal structure, but we have these very nice columns. This is helicity. Red and blue is positive and negative. Since I have this spoon that injects no helicity, I don't have a preferred sign. And helicity is really a small scale quantity. OK. Now, I go to the store, and I buy a special spoon that, when I steer the flow, injects a definite sign of helicity. Let's say this spoon injects only positive helicity. Okay, and I do the same experiment. I put the computer to run, and I let it run for several months. And what I get at the end is this. This is the entire box. This is just a subvolume. This is a 1500 cube. It was the largest simulation of a rotating flow done until we did the 3000 cube a couple of years ago. This run took 20 million CPU hours and 20,000 processors. So what we get are these very nice columns. These columns were not there at the beginning, okay? And the spoon is not creating these columns. The spoon is completely isotropic. So the columns result from a self-organization process. Now, what is really remarkable is how this very laminar and smooth column coexists with all this mess. Okay, this is something that we didn't expect. The red lines are trajectories of particles. So, and this is just to show you that the flow outside the main column is really smooth. We just release two particles and the particles stay together. Okay, so more pictures. So this is, again, entropy, so vorticity square. This is just a close-up, just to show you how these very fine grain and small-scale structures coexist with the column. This is helicity, just to show you, okay, the column is self-organized because it contains, and it's stable, and it lives for a very long time because it has a lot of helicity. So actually, these columns lives, we have tracked, the columns moves across the box for 10 turnover times. So these are very long-living columns. Okay, so here's another comparison. So here you have the smooth columns, you have helicity, you have this messy column with no net helicity, just to show you that introducing helicity makes a huge difference in the behavior of a rotating flow. Okay, so it will be a little bit more technical for a few minutes. So this is this is what people call the energy spectrum. This is something that people in turbulence do a lot. This is how much energy is contained in vortices with a given wave number. Okay? And there is a very well-known solution, which is the Kolmogorov spectrum. So if you have an isotropic and homogeneous flow, turbulent flow, you steer it without rotation, without stratification, what you expect to get is the Kolmogorov spectrum, k to the minus 5/3, and that's what you see there. Okay? Now, so this is a run, the solid line there is a run without rotation. And what you see there, the dashed line, is a run with rotation, no helicity, and the spectrum that shows up is a well-known spectrum, k to the minus 2. Okay, so what is important is to note that the solutions have this power loss, so the spectrum is in some way self-similar. There are corrections to that, but at this level, I think it's okay. So now, if we have helicity, this is what happens. The energy spectrum is actually steeper. I will show you in more detail what the spectrum looks like. And we have the helicity spectrum, which is shallower than what we get without helicity. So a few words about Kolmogorov turbulence. So I borrow these slides from Bill Matthews. This is a very classical picture of the Kolmogorov cascade. So if you have a turbulent flow, basically what happens is the following. Let's say you have your spoon in your box, you start to steer the flow. Okay, so you create a very large vortex. And that very large vortex, since your spoon is creating vortices at that scale, will excite a lot of energy in what people call the energy-containing scale. So if you take a bucket of water and you put a spoon and you start to steer it like that, you will see a very big vortex, okay? A very big eddy. And that very big eddy is the energy-containing eddy at the energy-containing scale. Now, that flow, sooner or later, will go unstable. And the vortex will break, the eddy will break in two eddies, and then it will break in four eddies, and so on. And that's basically a multiplicative process that will create the power law spectrum. Okay, and what you get is the k to the minus 5/3, which is remarkably easy to get. If you never heard of this, it's such a beautiful result because it takes two lines. So the only thing you have to assume is that you are injecting a certain amount of power at the energy-containing scale. Okay, so this is energy per unit of time. And then the only thing you have to say is, okay, so the amount of energy I inject here will be transferred to smaller and smaller scales where it will finally dissipate, okay? Now, the amount of energy that goes across any of these scales has to be the same. Now, the energy injection rate is just energy per unit of time, and the only way I can write energy per unit of time is to say, okay, it's U square divided by a characteristic time. This is the energy for a fixed mass, okay? And this is the time scale it takes for one eddy to break into two, and so on. Okay, from this, assuming epsilon is constant, you get that UL square goes as, okay, so I have to do something more. So what is the time scale to break the eddy? Time scale to break the eddy, I can only build one time scale. I have the velocity at a given scale, and I have the length scale of the eddy. So the time scale has to be L over UL from dimensional analysis. That's all I can do, okay? So from these two things together, you get that UL square goes as L to the 2/3. And if you write this as a spectrum, you get that E of K goes as k to the minus 5/3. This is just dimensional analysis. Okay, so that's the famous Kolmogorov solution. In a rotating flow, what happens is that we have the eddies and the waves. Okay, and the waves, when you have waves, you have interference, right? So, and you can have constructive interference or destructive interference. That's what people in fluid dynamics call the resonant condition. So to be able to get this cascade, your waves have to resonate. You need constructive interference to be able to transfer the energy from one scale to the next. And when you take that into account, basically, there is a lot of theory done by Claude Cambon and collaborators, but the simplest argument goes like this. I have the energy transfer rate, and the waves will slow down the cascade, so the simplest thing I can assume is to say that the slowdown is linear with the ratio of the two time scales. So then I multiply this by the time scale associated with the rotation and the time scale of the cascade. And from that, you get a spectrum that is k to, you repeat this process and you get a spectrum that is k to the minus 2. So basically, the shallower spectrum, so the fact that smaller eddies have less energy at smaller scales, comes from the resonance condition. Okay, so it comes from the effect of the waves in the flow. Okay, so what do we have in the helical case? In the helical case, what we have is that, so this is a rotating flow with my special spoon that injects a lot of helicity. And what we have is that, so these are what people call compensated spectra. The compensated spectra is just the spectrum multiplied by the power law, so the spectrum is flat, and it's easier to recognize the power law. So here you can see that the energy spectrum is steeper than the helicity spectrum. And when you look at the fluxes, so how much energy and helicity is transferred to smaller scales, you see that more helicity is transferred to smaller scales than energy. So if I use this special spoon that injects a lot of helicity, instead of having a cascade of eddies, I have a cascade of corkscrews. Okay? So we have a right-wing corkscrew that breaks into two that break into four that break into eight, and it's trivial to do the dimensional analysis and get that if that's the case, then the product of these two spectra has to be k to the minus 4. Okay, the theory is really easy to do. I won't go through the details, but basically what you have to assume now is that helicity is the quantity that is cascading, and you assume a constant flux of helicity, and then you get that the product of energy and helicity has to be k to the minus 4, and this we have verified in a lot of simulations at different resolutions. Okay, so in a helical rotating flow, you have a direct cascade of helicity that when it's dominant, it gives you a different scaling than in the case without helicity. Okay, so how all these connects with the motivations I was showing you at the beginning of the talk. So what we know now is that the presence of helicity affects the scaling of the flow. So it's not the same to have right wing corkscrews only, or to have right wing and left wing. Okay, but besides changing the spectrum, does this have any effect on the on what we expect from a turbulent flow? And the answer is, well, there are really nice examples in which having helicity or not makes a difference. Okay, so I will show you a few. There are a couple that I like a lot. So, okay, so one is, the first one is, does helicity affect the decay of turbulence? Remember Lilly in his 1986 paper, his claim was, okay, a flow that has helicity should live longer than a flow without helicity. What you see here is energy as a function of time, in log-log, okay? And this is just the decay. So basically, the experiment here is you take a bucket of water, you steer your flow, at some point, you remove your spoon, and you let the system decay. And you measure how much energy you have as a function of time. So these are just two test cases, so let's look at the solid line. This is energy as a function of time without helicity, without rotation. So the bucket of water is not rotating, and it decays like a power law, because the spectrum is a power law, you have this self-similar decay. Now, what I will really care about is the fact that having helicity or not having helicity does not affect the decay if I don't have rotation. Now, if I have rotation, no helicity, the energy decays more or less as time to the minus one. So as I go to later times, I have less energy with something that goes as 1 over t. If I have helicity, what we get is something that is compatible with minus 1/3. Now, these three values I can predict from a theory that takes this into account. Okay, so that's why this is nice, because the decay law you get is more or less what you expect from the theory. Now, what is really important here is that note the rotating bucket of water without helicity and the rotating bucket of water with helicity decay in a very different way. Actually, after 30 or 40 turnover times, I have one order of magnitude difference in the energy. Okay? So this flow has one order of magnitude more energy than this flow. Okay? So this is something that is, at least for me, really tantalizing. It's really nice because it is really starting to connect with some of the ideas of Lilly, that when you have helicity in a flow, the flow will survive for longer times. Okay, so another simple example, and this is really important for applications. If you don't know anything about turbulence, probably the only thing you know is that it's really efficient at mixing. So that's what we do when we add sugar to our coffee. We stir the coffee because turbulent mixing is way more efficient than molecular mixing. Okay, you don't just pour the sugar and wait for molecular diffusion to do the work. Okay, to get coefficients, transport coefficients for the turbulent diffusion is really important for a lot of applications. So one of the things we did is to say, okay, does helicity affect the mixing we get? And one of the ways to measure that is you start with your flow and you put some initial tracer and you let it just decay. So you let the tracer be mixed by the turbulence. This is in a rotating box seen from top. That's why you see this S-shaped profile because of the Coriolis force. Okay? So, and actually very recently we were able to measure that actually the turbulent transport coefficient is weaker when you have helicity. So a rotating helical flow diffuses less than a rotating non-helical flow. Okay, for people working in fluid dynamics, that's something that you can expect from the fact that the spectrum is steeper in the rotating helical case, because to the lowest order in any perturbation theory, the turbulent diffusion goes as the fluctuating velocity square. And since a helical rotating flow has less fluctuations than a non-helical rotating flow, that's what you expect. Okay, so this is a result that was obtained by someone else, by Edristiti and Biferale. But this is a result I really like because it connects with some of the things we have been doing, and it's also very important for the fundamental of what we understand of the Navier-Stokes equation. What Biferale and Titi did is the following. If you take the Navier-Stokes equation and you Fourier transform this equation and you dot this equation with the velocity, you get what people call the detailed energy balance. People working in field theories will probably read this as normal mode expansion. Okay? So this term, when you dot it with the velocity and you Fourier transform, you get this term. And this is the term that is responsible for the cascade. So basically, this is a term that tells us that energy at a given wave number q is transferred to energy at a different wave number k interacting with another eddy. So in terms of Feynman diagrams, this tells us that all Feynman diagrams for Navier-Stokes have three legs. Okay? So interactions are between three eddies. So what In this expansion, these are basically linearly polarized waves, okay? But you can change the base and go to circularly polarized waves. I didn't write the equations, but they look a lot like that. Instead, but this amplitude now is the amplitude of a helically polarized waves. If you do that, now you can play with your equations and say, okay, what happens if I let only interactions happen between three corkscrews with the same sign? So I forbid all interactions with circularly polarized waves with the other hand, okay? So I keep, for example, only right-hand polarized waves, and I removed all left-hand polarized waves. If you do that, it turns out that you can prove that the, what people call the helical decimated version of Navier-Stokes, so that's just the Navier-Stokes equations with only right-hand polarized waves. If you do that, it turns out you can show that these equations are regular at all time. So you have no finite time singularity. Okay, this is a very nice result, because this is this may be one of the closest results to show regularity of the Navier-Stokes equations. So now the road to get singularity or regularity is if there is a singularity, singularity has to come from interactions of these guys with these guys. Okay, so at least we know what interactions do not create a singularity. These interactions do not create a singularity. If there is a singularity, it comes from the interactions between waves with different polarizations. Now, the other nice thing is, in this case, in the helical decimated equations, you get a direct cascade of helicity and an inverse cascade of energy. And that's exactly what happens in the simulations I will show you before. Okay, the simulations I was showing you before of rotating helical turbulence have a direct cascade of helicity. This is a flux. And positive means helicity goes to smaller scales. And energy is negative, so energy goes to larger scales. Okay, so the self-organization process in rotating turbulence removes energy from the direct cascade and leaves, in practice, the helical decimated version of the Navier-Stokes equations at the small scales. This is a natural case in which this happens without tampering with the equations. Okay, so a quick few words about a little bit more realistic problems. So this was a very simplified problem, just a rotating flow. Here I introduced, in the previous problem, a rotating flow, I introduced helicity with my special spoon. And that's something you don't really get in a shop, okay? That's really artificial. So the question is, if we want to go to atmospheric flows, the question is really, can we create helicity spontaneously and in a more natural way in a flow? And the answer is we can, okay? So to study an atmospheric problem, the simplest model we can use is we go back to the Euler equation, we add viscosity, so we have the Navier-Stokes, we have rotation, and we add stratification. So now we have a stratified flow. Here, this is the temperature. We have a stratified flow. We need an equation for the temperature, which is basically advected and diffused by the velocity field. So now you can imagine you have this we have the same box in the rotating table, and on top of that, we added stratification. So the flow on the bottom is heavier than the flow in the fluid on top. Okay, so this is a very, very simple model of what happens in the atmosphere, but it works. So now we have the Froude number. Besides Rossby and Reynolds, we have the Froude number, which measures basically the strength of the stratification. So this is how stratified flow looks like for different levels of stratification. This is more stratified than this guy. This is rotating and stratified, so you can see the layers. Blue and green means hotter or colder than the background, okay? So what you see there are temperature fluctuations. We have these layers that have an angle, and the angle is associated with the rotation. Here you see another picture of a rotating and stratified flow. That's temperature, this is the direction of stratification, and this is also the direction of rotation. You can see the layers, and that's what you expect for a rotating flow. Now, a little bit more math, it's really simple math. So if we go to the momentum equation, it's easy to write an equation for the balance of helicity. Basically, the only thing we have to do is we dot this equation with the vorticity and we integrate in volume. Okay, and what we get is that the time evolution of the helicity now is not zero anymore. What we have is, this is just dissipation. So dissipation, as I told you at the beginning, can break links and destroy helicity. But now we have a source. The source is associated with alignment between the vertical component of the vorticity and the temperature. So if these two, if there is a correlation between these two guys, we can inject helicity. Of course, we need this correlation to be well correlated, right? If we just have random noise, we won't get any injection. Now, it turns out that if at the large scales, we repeat the game of linearizing the equation. So we say, well, at the large scales, the flow is smooth. So let's forget about all these terms, and let's look at the balance between pressure gradients, gravity, and Coriolis force. This balance here is really important in atmospheric sciences. It's called the geostrophic balance. If we assume this balance holds at large scales, and you replace this in this equation, you get that the system goes to an asymptotic value of the helicity, which is given by this. Okay? So if you start with any rotating and stratified flow, and you let it decay, the flow will spontaneously create helicity, which will be given by the ratio of the frequency of the gravity waves to the rotation times the vertical component of the velocity times, so the correlation of the vertical component of the velocity times vertical gradients of the temperature. Okay? And if you do a lot of simulations, that's compatible with what you get. So what you see here is amount of helicity created by the flow, and this was the right-hand side prediction in the equations. And you see the points lie on a straight line, and this is with even more runs, and all the points lie on a straight line. When you go outside of the hypothesis you made, of course, everything breaks down, but you still create a definite sign of helicity. So what is really nice is now we have a mechanism to spontaneously create helicity in a more realistic flow. Okay, so I will finish here. Let me just, because this is something I'm having a lot of fun right now, just take 1 minute. So a lot of what I showed you was either theoretical or numerical. Most of what I showed you was numerical because I didn't go through the details of the theory, but there is a reason why I work like that and people in fluid dynamics work like that. Turbulence is a very complicated phenomenon in which the Reynolds number is the equivalent of a coupling constant in any field, in any field theory. And the Reynolds number in atmospheric sciences tends to be something between 10 to the 8 to 10 to the 10, and in astrophysics can be larger than 10 to the 12. So it is really a theory in which when you try to do asymptotic perturbations, you don't get anything, unless you make really good hypotheses to start with. So the way numerical simulations help is by allowing you to find out what are the right hypotheses when you do either theory or phenomenology. And you have this continuous interplay between numerical simulations and theory, or between experiments and theory. In the last year and a half, I decided to start building a lab with Pablo Covelli, who was a PhD student and later a postdoc in Paris, and now we convinced him to go back to Argentina, so we're starting to build this lab. And the idea is to do surface waves, so this is, now the experiment is actually much larger, but this was one of our first prototypes. This is a tank with water. We use something to dye the water so it looks like milk. We project the pattern on the surface, we use a fast camera to capture the deformation of the surface. This is in detail, so here we are generating waves in the surface, and basically we are capturing the deformation of the surface. This looks like a simulation, but it's not. This is a reconstruction of the deformation of the surface from an experiment, okay? It's really, the method is really nice. Well, actually, this is not the same problem. Here we are creating linear waves, and this is a drop. But it serves for the purpose of illustrating the method. So our next step is really to go into not only spatial spectra, as I was showing you before, but time, frequency, and wavelength spectra to get time and spatial spectral information to be able to go beyond what we have been doing so far. Okay, so I will leave the conclusions for you, and thank you very much, and thank you again for the prize. It's a tremendous honor. Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much, Pablo. It was a great presentation. So at this time, for questions.
First of all, thank you very much for the nice talk. I wanted to ask you about this result of Biferrale. You were saying that the energy cascade is an inverse cascade, whereas the helicity cascade is a direct cascade. So, first of all, maybe you can explain a little bit more what is an inverse cascade, because essentially, I mean, are you injecting energy at low scale? How realistic or what type of physical system would correspond to that?
Okay, thank you very much. So, we are used to the idea that a turbulent flow is something very complicated and that it's messy, and that's not always the case. Okay, so let me go to the spectrum. So let's say you have your bucket of water, but instead of steering the flow at the largest available scale, you create mid-sized eddies. Okay, so you have a wave number at which you force, and you have room at larger scales, and you have room in free space at smaller scales. If you have a 3D isotropic flow, what will happen is what I was telling you before. So the eddies will break into two smaller eddies, and you will get the power law spectrum, and that's a direct cascade. So the flux is positive, and energy goes towards larger wave numbers. Now, let's say you have a 2D flow. Okay, you have a flow in a very thin film. In that case, you have two quantities that are concerned. You have the energy, and you have the entropy, so the square of the vorticity. In that case, the system has to, in the limit of zero viscosity, conserve both quantities. And with finite viscosity, it has to dissipate one quantity faster than the other. Okay? So then what happens is that entropy, vorticity, goes to smaller scales, and energy goes to larger scales. So two eddies basically create a larger eddy and so on. Okay, that's what people call an inverse cascade. It's a self-organization process. The rotating flow is in between a 2D flow and a 3D flow. And so you can get an inverse cascade of energy, and you can get a direct cascade of energy. The case of Biferrale is special because what Luca Biferrale did was to take a 3D flow, isotropic, so you should only get a direct cascade of energy, and helicity follows. So both energy and helicity both go to small scales. Biferrale truncated the equations to get a flow in which you only have circularly polarized right wing modes. And then suddenly this arrow changes sign, and you have a self-organization of the energy. So energy goes to larger scales, and the corkscrew goes to smaller scales. It's really a self-organization process, and you can actually see it in a lot of in experiments and even in nature. So the turbulent flow does not have to be as messy as we imagine when we look at 3D turbulence. Okay.
More questions?
My question is the following. So I'm not a specialist in the this field, and I have only knowledge about some analogy between turbulence and things which happen in quantum disorder wave functions of, let's say, Anderson localization problem and things like that. So what I'm interested in, I'm trying to ask questions using your language, but I'm sorry if I will be mistaken.
Because, it's okay.
So there is a phenomenon of intermittency, right?
Yes.
So there is a certain spectrum of exponents which is a correlation function of the powers of velocity. And this is something that we have very close analogy in,
yes.
In quantum disordered system. My question is this spectrum affected by helicity or not?
Okay, thank you very much. Yes, it is. Yeah, that's a very good question. Actually, it's a very good question because Harry Sweeney has worked a lot on that. So intermittency is a deviation from perfect self-similarity, okay? So when you have a turbulent flow, the smaller scales tend to have stronger gradients than what you would expect if the system would have been normally distributed. Okay, and as you look at smaller and smaller scales, you have stronger and stronger gradients. So that's intermittency. The way to characterize intermittency or deviations from self-similarity here or in condensed matter is to look at the scaling exponents. So the scaling exponents do change. So turbulence is multifractal. 3D turbulence is strongly multifractal. Rotating turbulence is less intermittent, but it's still intermittent. When you have a rotating helical flow, there is almost no intermittency. Okay, so as you increase the amount of helicity in a rotating flow, intermittency decreases. The multifractality in a rotating helical flow is very weak, and that's because of the presence of helicity. Without helicity, a rotating flow is still intermittent and multifractal. And actually, I do think that I had in one of my slides, I had a text that actually cited previous works by Professor Harry Sweeney. There are some conflicting results when you do experiments between scaling exponents in some experiments and in others. And I guess that it may be associated with how turbulence is created and the amount of helicity in the flow. So let me tell you something more about that. So when you look at this flow, this is the flow with helicity. These columns seem to be playing a very important role in making the flow more multifractal. When you don't get these very nice columns, you get more intermittency.
This is actually this picture that we
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Joe? Well, thanks. A very interesting talk. Now I know why Keith Moffat was so excited. We thought we were going to link up vortices and water by your second slide. Cecilia Rai is one of your authors, and so I know she came from University of Maryland. She was actually here also as a PhD student. Did you catch the bug of looking at superfluid turbulence or turbulence in, say, Bose-Einstein condenses? Because these are very interesting flows that are they're kind of reconnecting Euler flows. And they also have classical cascade, and then it goes to something with helical motions with a k to minus 2. I don't know if you're going in this direction or you think that maybe some work in this could shed light on classical turbulence. That's one question. The other question is kind of practical. So on this slide, Reynolds numbers go up to 10,000, and I think you said atmospheric flows are 10 to the 8, and astrophysical flows are up to 10 to the 12. What is the prognosis for computers architectures being able to take these simulations? And do you think that what difference is that? Do you think that will make?
Okay, so those are very nice questions. So. Yeah, I'm planning to go into some superfluid turbulence, not with Cecilia. We just wrote a proposal with Mark Rachet. But with Cecilia, we worked on this very same problem, but in stratified flows. So we have been looking at purely stratified flows and the effect of helicity in a purely stratified flow. Okay, so concerning, so your last question was the computer and prognosis. Okay, from the point of view of reaching 10 to the 8, in the Reynolds, I think the prognosis are really bad. We will probably have to wait for at least a century. But, so now we are, the largest run we have done so far was done using 98,000 cores. Okay, that was it's a run we're actually still cooking. It's a 4,000 cube with stratification. The largest we can do is around 100,000 cores. Now our code also includes support for GPUs, which gives a little bit more, an extra speed up. But people are talking about 1 million cores, which would be nice. Well, there are already computers with 1 million cores. But in any case, every time you, so to double the Reynolds number, you have to increase your grids by a huge factor. So it goes as Reynolds to the 9 ports, right? So it goes as the power of the Reynolds, and that's a real killer. So that's bad. The good news is every time we double the resolution, we learn something new. So when we did the 1500 cube, this is the 1500 cube, we were really happy, we got these columns, and it was nice. And then you wonder, okay, so why should we do a 3000 cube that takes just 1 year to cook? So what we did was, we said, okay, if the theory is correct for a helical flow, we should be able to predict what should be the parameters to get this effect. And what we wanted to get was recovery of isotropy at small scales, which is a big deal, right? So we wanted to get the anisotropic large-scale rotating spectrum and get the -5/3 at small scales. This was a very risky run because you ask for 25 million hours and you have one shot. You prepare the run, you predict the parameters. If you're right, you get a really nice run. If you're wrong, you get crap. So, and then you have to explain the guy that owns the supercomputer what you have done in the last year. But we did that, and we got recovery of isotropy. So every time you double the resolution, you discover a new effect. So from that point of view, it's really nice that computers keep getting bigger and bigger. From the point of view of getting 10 to the 8, I'm sorry. Okay.
Eddie?
I have simpler questions. One is technical, and is in your water experiment, why do you get two branches? The other more general question is, what is the conditions of science in Argentina these days? You mentioned very large resources. At least you don't have to put the owner of the computer as the first author, like it was done long ago. But it also looked rather impressive and serious resources. So Argentina seems to be coming a long way. I wanted to hear more about this.
Okay, thank you. You have a very quick eye because I showed that slide for a few seconds. Okay. Yeah, you got the two branches. Okay, so this is the energy spectrum as a function of frequency and wave number. So what you see, the dark lines there, and this is normalized. So you can see that's basically a dispersion relation for the waves. And so why should we get two branches? And the answer is really nice. This experiment, and this, we can do the same with simulations. This was done in the regime of shallow water. So in the shallow water regime, waves are not dispersive. Okay, now, as the flow gets a little bit shallower, you get boosiness. So you start to get dispersion. What happens is that you have, this is a turbulent flow, so you have waves, and you have waves mounted on top of waves. Now, some waves see a deep flow, some waves see a shallow flow. So there is a range of scales in which you have both waves coexisting, depending on whether you are, whether they're mounted on top of a very big wave or not. Yeah. Yeah, that was quick. Okay, so, but I will answer. So, so concerning resources, I have a multi-resource approach to the things we do. So for some of these things, we need very big simulations, very big. We don't have a 10,000 core supercomputer in Argentina or larger. So I have a code which is called Ghost, which I started to develop when I was a PhD student. And I kept developing it in collaboration with more and more people. Now I have a community of people that work in the code. And then we do a lot of runs in collaboration in different places. And some of the runs I showed you were done in Idris in France, a lot of the runs in the US. We are now running in Titan, which has a lot of GPUs. So the big runs are run in places like that. Then in Buenos Aires, I build clusters of different sizes, and we use those clusters for the PhD students and for our regular runs. These are smaller clusters, but since we own the clusters, we can run for very long times. So we have one cluster that now we are scaling to 256 cores, and we have another cluster with 128 cores, and that's more than enough for all the PhD students in our group to do a lot of runs. And those are regularly cheap. With $60,000, you can build a very nice cluster. And for the lab we are building from scratch, we got a grant which is between $300,000 and $400,000 to buy equipment. The funding in Argentina right now is really good. So from that point of view, we are happy. We are... Okay, thank you.
Harry, you have some comment?
The controversy about extreme turbulence and convection, whether it's the power law for the Nusselt number versus Rayleigh number, ultimately goes, as Krishnadip proposed, to value 1/2, or is it in extreme limit 1/3? Do you see any resolution of that controversy?
As we increase the resolution?
No, it won't come from computing, yeah. But from thinking, I think.
Oh, okay, that's a tough one. I don't know about that particular case, but in other problems, what computers have brought, the fact that we can do larger runs and we can do multiple big runs, and it may be the case in that problem. From the time of Kolmogorov, the theory of turbulence was really built on top of the idea of universality, the idea that no matter how you steer the flow, you get the same solution. And that's true in many cases, but it's the extension to other problems is not trivial. So for example, in MHD, people for a long time tried to get the universal spectrum of MHD turbulence, and there was a controversy like that on whether it's Kreichner. Now some people believe that maybe there is no unique spectrum. Some people claim that there is one. Some people claim that depending on how you steer the flow, whether you inject more alpha waves or more energy in the eddies, you get different solutions. And that may be the case in other problems. So the problem really comes from the fact that when you have only one time scale, as in Kolmogorov, things are easy. When you have two, this is a nice guess, but you may have another guess. So computers may help there, in at least showing that for different steering forces, you may get different spectra. And from there, we may be able to break this barrier that any theory has to be a universal theory. There can be a change there in the coming years.
Okay, well, thank you very much, Pablo, for such a great presentation, and congratulations again for such a well-deserved prize.